So the last time that we were here, we were starting to set ourselves up in an Android development environment. And obviously doing it here in the classroom, it looked so easy, so effortless. And then maybe you tried to do it at home and it wasn't as effortless as you thought it would be. So that's sometimes what happens. That's why I have these various handouts that I've put together that I check and I double check as the semester starts to try to perhaps deal with any contingencies that might happen, but things always happen, things always change, and if, as I come across them, I let you know. The software is always changing. If you took my SEO class yesterday, I mentioned in there that SEO is a moving target. Well, app development is also a moving target because these companies provide you the SDKs and they provide you the code and such. And it all works at this point in time, and then maybe 6 months later, 3 months later, a week later, new versions come out. So it's a moving target to do app development. So I would say my recommendation is once you've got your system set up, and it all seems to work, don't do updates until you're done with your project cycle. I wouldn't really recommend to update your software in the middle of a project. You don't know what things are going to break. Maybe you're going to get better APIs or more interesting code, useful code, but you don't know how that's going to affect your current project. And you don't want to stop halfway through a project to now learn something new to continue what you were trying to do. So for us at the moment, our computer should have the latest version of the software. Therefore, we're not going to need to update anything and we'll be fine. So I've got for you in the network folder, if you open the computer, if you open the computer window, and you go to the network location, and you scroll down to find my folder, Campus Android 2. Open that up. So number 1 and number 2 and number 2B are still there, and now we've got number 3 and number 4. So when I teach these classes, we have a variety of students with a variety of skills and abilities. And so some of us, this stuff is moving at a good pace. For some of us, this stuff is moving slightly faster than we would want. And for some of us, this stuff is moving slower than we would want. There's a big range, everyone. So I try to give a little bit to everyone. I'm going to teach in the middle to reach as most people. As many people as possible. If you're falling behind, that's when you raise your hand, that's when you wait for the break, that's when you wait for the lab time. If you feel things are a bit slow, I'll be also offering items that go a little bit beyond that we'll catch up with. So right now, as I said, I've given items up to number 4. We're gonna do number 3. If you got that done, okay, then you can go on to 4, but this is my procedure. So go ahead and copy sheets number 3 and 4 to your desktop or flash drive. Get a copy of those. If you're on a laptop, you might have to ask your neighbor for a copy from their computer. Or if you give me your USB drive, I'll give you a copy up here. Once you copy 3 and 4, we'll look at number 3. Again, you can print any of these that you want, but during the break, if we look at number 3, I introduce something new here, Node.js. How many of you heard of Node.js before this class? A couple of people. If you haven't, Node.js allows us to use Cordova, also known as PhoneGap. We will use Cordova to write HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, and have the code translated to the appropriate platform's native code. Node.js will allow us to set up to update Cordova and plugins. So Node.js is this other software that allows us to install software and to update our projects, and we're going to need it as one of our yet another one of our foundations. This is obviously installed on our computers already, but at home this is another piece of the puzzle that you would install. It's a free download, of course. You get it at nodejs.org. You download it for Windows or Mac. This one does have an installation file. Remember, we talked about ANT, And Ant didn't have an installation file, so this one has an installation file, and it adds itself to the path already. So you don't have to do that part. And basically, this gives us a slightly different version of the command prompt that we will be using to type our commands. Remember, we looked at the tip of the iceberg of the command prompt previously with cd this and that, and what else? CLS, and a few simple command line commands. This will allow us to use more specifically to create our actual Android projects via Cordova. So this is already installed, and when I checked this morning, it's on version 12.7. Oh, there's a little misspelling there. So it's on 12.7. I forgot to update that, 12.0. It's on 12.7, you install it, choose your defaults, and you get a brand new application. It'll show up in your start menu, or in your applications folder if you're on the Mac. And then here, just as a sanity check to see everything's installed, let's do this part here, where it says confirm all the software is installed and ready to use. Go to your start menu. On the start menu, start typing node. N-O-D-E, and you should get the result that says node.js command prompt. We could technically do what we're about to do in the plain old command prompt, but here we're using the node version of it because it gives us the extra tools that we need to do our app development. So in the start menu, search node and select node command prompt. You see it looks like before, except that at the top it'll say something like your environment has been set up for using node.js 12.3. And npm. So here I'm saying, well, we've done a couple of these before, but there's a couple new ones. Let's check one more time our version of Java, our version of Ant, and then we'll check our version of Node and npm. So on the command prompt here, we'll type Java space dash version. I have 1.8.0.45, Ant space dash version. We have 1.9.4. You'll get 1.9.6 if you do this at home. And then we'll do node space dash v. Here it's showing us 12.3. If you download this at home right now, you'd get 12.7. No need to update this stuff. It works. And lastly, something that I haven't talked about yet, npm dash v. So Java is our foundation where a lot of this software runs on top of. Ant is the software that we use to compile or to convert the code into the Android project. Node is this sort of super software. You can kind of think about it like an app store, kind of, in that you can install other stuff through it. Just like you go to your app store and get new software, via Node, we can install other things, specifically using npm, which is the Node Package Manager. So we've got these versions. They may or may not line up with my handout. That's okay. We're not going to be able to update our software to every cutting-edge version in the lab here for logistical reasons. But this is the software we've got, and this is all that we need at the moment. Before we do this setup Cordova part, let's open our web browser. And let's go to this website that we'll be spending a lot of time on called cordova.apache.org. Cordova.apache.org. Last time, we looked at ant.apache.org. And as I said, Apache is one of the most important players on the web. They are this organization about open source software, and they are one of the stewards of the various open source projects throughout the world. So here, Cordova is a part of that. It's residing on their official server, and they have this status as a sort of officially maintained Apache software. So we get it from this site here. And at this site, what we would be seeing is the little Cordova mascot. It probably has a name, but it's this little cube robot thing. And it says Apache Cordova is a platform for building native mobile applications using HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So when we talk about native code, that's the code that is the official code for creating an app. So for Android, it would be Java. For the iPhone, it would be Objective-C or Swift. And for Windows Phone, it would be C#, and then other such software for different platforms. That's the native code. And so what we're doing is we're going to be using HTML, CSS, and JavaScript web code, non-native code. And what Cordova does is it basically translates that HTML, CSS, and JavaScript to the native code. Because there is that extra middleman, however, as was asked previously, there are concerns of performance issues, which manifest themselves most on graphically intensive apps, like games. So perhaps going the Cordova route might not be the best for your particular project. You sort of don't know until you actually test it, until you try your project on a virtual device or your real device, and as many as possible. But for most people, this is going to be one of the best ways to get up and running quickly in making an app. And notice it's not just focused on an Android app. With Cordova, we can create an Android app, an iPhone app, a Windows Phone app, a Mac app, a Windows 8 or Windows 10 app, a Firefox app, a Linux app, Ubuntu Linux, etc. So Cordova, this high-level Apache project, is a middleman to convert our humble web projects into native, hybrid native apps. We're going to spend time at the site as the class goes on, because here we will be looking at what's the latest news, and more importantly, the documentation of how it all works. So we'll look at that in a bit. But as we scroll down, there's a download button. Don't worry about that just yet. What is this? It's a set of device APIs that allow a mobile app developer to access native device function, such as the camera or accelerometer, from JavaScript. So instead of writing the Java-specific code that only works on Android, we would write a JavaScript command that is then translated to the appropriate command in Java, Objective-C, and C#, etc., because of Cordova. Combined with a user interface framework such as jQuery Mobile or Dojo Mobile or Sencha Touch, this allows a smartphone app to be developed with just HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So last month we learned a good amount of jQuery Mobile to create the interface of our project. We were easily able to create a navigation menu and pop-up boxes and all that cool stuff because the jQuery Mobile library made it quick. Alternatives to that are Dojo Mobile, Sencha Touch, and a host of others. And I can't give you the answer which is better, because I would have to learn them all to give you my opinion. Well, it's a framework to create a user interface. So when using the Cordova APIs, an app can be built without any native code from the app developer. Instead, web technologies are used, and they are hosted on the app itself locally, generally not on a remote server. So this web project that we created won't be up on a server, although it could. It's going to be in an actual app that is wrapped around and it's found on your device. Because these JavaScript APIs are consistent across multiple device platforms and built on web standards, the app should be portable to other device platforms with minimal to no changes. Goes on and on and on. It's available for all platforms, documentation, blah blah blah. That's good. And then we've got news. June 22nd, pretty recently, the software was updated. If we take a quick look here, these are some of the things that we will be able to tap into via JavaScript. We'll be able to tap into the device's battery status, its camera, looking at contacts on the device, dialog boxes, files on the device, media. We will be able to capture media, record media, tap into the vibration. So that's how we can turn our humble web project into a full-featured app, because a real app can check a person's contact list to send them a message. A real app can take a photo and do something with it. A real app can vibrate when you get an error message. And we'll be able to do all of that via writing a little bit of JavaScript. If you've been following PhoneGap or Cordova for a while, a big change happened when they went over to version 5. They started to implement using more NPM, which is the Node Package Manager, which you get when you install Node. So to install these plugins, you don't download them here and put them in your project. You type a quick command, Node or NPM plugin install camera. And now you've got camera abilities. We'll do it together, of course. But if you're not familiar with older versions of Cordova, don't worry about it. This is just the way it's done. So just some more info. That's nice. Keep going. June 10th, it also showed there was an update. So this is updated on a regular basis. I'm going to skip this new stuff. Want to contribute. So if you want to be a part of this global project to help make it better, there is a way to contribute to it and become a developer. Maybe you can edit the wiki, report bugs, help improve it. So this is, again, the ethos of open source. A lot of people looking at a particular project to improve it together. And it has improved. I remember using PhoneGap years ago, and it was very clunky, very slow, buggy, and it's gotten much, much better as time goes on. So I keep going, and it's going to give me lots of links and so forth. That's fine. All about the plugins, mailing list. And download. Okay, how do I actually use it? So, that's what my sheet is for. To actually use it, we don't download it and install it like a regular software, like we would do Node itself or Java and such. We install it through the command line. And again, if this is scary, if seeing, you know, black and white text is scary, it doesn't have to be. We just need to learn a few commands, and we'll be able to do something quickly rather than hunting for the app, hunting for the button, clicking something and getting it done through the graphical user interface. We can get it done quickly through one quick command. Okay, if you're on Cordova, .apache.org. If you're not there yet, scroll all the way to the bottom and then back up a little bit to the downloads and archives. So scroll all the way down. I think if you click that download, it jumps you there anyway. But go down to the download and archives. It's recommended that the Cordova command line interface, the CLI or CLI, be installed from NPM rather than downloading the zip version. For more info, read this. So let's do that. Scroll down to the Downloads and Archives and click the link that says Command Line Interface. This takes us over to the Cordova manual. All of the chapters are here. All the information is here, updated on a regular basis. But this is where all your answers are going to be. Besides this class, the manual here at cordova.apache.org is going to be one of the places you're going to be looking up. How does this thing work again? And the third place you're going to be getting your information for development is this amazing website that if you haven't heard of it, you really need to check it out. It's called stackoverflow.com. Stack Overflow is a question and answer site for professional and enthusiast programmers. It's 100% free. So Stack Overflow is part of the larger Stack Exchange network, but Stack Overflow focuses on programming in HTML, in JavaScript, in Cordova, etc., etc., etc. And it works by people asking a question and knowledgeable people giving an answer. You think, well, can anyone give a bad answer? Of course. But this is based on upvoting and downvoting. So if a bad answer appears and people know what they're talking about, they're going to downvote it. If a good answer appears that answers the question, people are going to upvote it, and the cream should rise to the top. So taking just a quick look here, my Java application does not read my files using Maven. So far there's one answer on that. Quadratic equation solver fails to result in Java. Two answers on that. How to know a user has moved to a new card in Google Glass app? One answer on that. So people are asking questions, people are giving answers. You can search, of course, at the top right. For example, search Cordova. So if you go to the top right and click search Cordova, people will be asking these questions, and there probably will be a question that you have that someone has asked, and even better, probably even answered. Such as, error, Android home is not set, and Android command not in your path. Well, that's one of the things that I've addressed in my handouts. One of the main issues always happens when you set the stuff up. It doesn't work. Why? Because the path might not be set up right. So Stack Overflow is great. It's part of Stack Exchange. You don't have to do this, but I'm going to take a quick detour over to Stack Exchange. I'm going to go to stackexchange.com. Stack Exchange is the larger umbrella of categories of question and answers. Stackexchange.com, if you look at on the top right, all sites, you will see that there are sections devoted to programming, Stack Overflow, server fault, so all about server admin and such, super user, the arcade, about game programming and such, Ubuntu, Linux, mathematics, game development there, theoretical computer science, role-playing games, bicycles, science fiction and fantasy, travel, skeptics. I'm going to take a quick look at what the hot questions are on science fiction and fantasy for a moment. Which captain ordered the most crew to their deaths? One answer. I'm going to guess Kirk. Let's see what the answers are. First of all, Picard is no stranger to the auto self-destruct sequence. There, in Star Trek Nemesis, Picard rams the Enterprise-E nose first into the Scimitar without ordering an evacuation. That's true, of the forward saucer section. Anyway, people can answer a variety of questions, from the frivolous to the not. And that's all part of the whole Stack Exchange network of questions and answers. So I've found a bunch of answers on what I'm looking for, programming-wise. And in the last class, remember, we did that GPS map thing, and I said that I had gotten part of the answer from a Stack Exchange question, and so I was able to get that answer and provide it for you. And so Stack Exchange, Stack Overflow, very, very useful. And later on, I've got to come back and read this answer. Why does Yoda speak the way he does? But I'll be strong and I'll check it later.
There is one more actually in similar Quora.
Yes, that's another one. Although it's not as I don't think it's not as taken off as much. But this other one that you can also look at, question and answers, is Quora, Q-U-O-R-A, Quora.com, and that's also about questions and answers. It's been around a few years, but definitely Stack Exchange and Stack Overflow has been the darling and been the one that most people use. You do get a different caliber of questions here. It's pretty cool. And it's a variety of topics, of course. There was one that was asked, like, what software runs Instagram? And guess what? Someone that works at Instagram answered it. So Quora sort of has a bit more of a fame about, like, people behind the scenes of things are answering the questions, I think, more than at Stack Exchange. Stack Overflow. Someone asked, what does it feel like to have your Hollywood movie bomb? And the director of the last Conan movie answered it. Because remember the last Conan movie? He doesn't either. But Quora is cool, it's useful, but definitely you'll get more answers. And notice you have to log in and such. But over at Stack Exchange or Stack Overflow. It's really useful. So what I'm getting at with these sites is, this is, you're gonna have, we're gonna be in a class, I'm gonna give you handouts, I'm gonna give you help. But if you need help on the weekend, that might be a bit slow. If you pass this class or you finish this class and move on and you need more help, I'm not gonna be around. Maybe I can answer a bit as best as I can on email, but you have to also find resources and educate yourself. And these three are one of the big ones. Straight from the horse's mouth, Apache, Cordova.apache.org, Stack Overflow, and Quora, and others, of course. But these are the big ones where you'll be self-diagnosing and getting answers. Okay, so if you're still here at this Apache Cordova site, I'm going to take a quick look at a couple of things. If you're not here, that's okay. But the manual here talks about setting all of this up via the command line. We've got Node installed. We've got the command line, the command prompt right here, command line, command prompt, same thing. There's about prerequisites and all of that. The way you actually install it, and it's already done on our computer, so don't do it. It says, well, you're going to be in the terminal, and then you're going to, on Windows, for example, you would type npm install-g Cordova. npm is the Node package manager. That's for you to install extra software. So Cordova is part of the npm, you know, the package manager, so we can type npm install. Install what? Cordova. The dash g means global, so that means you'll be able to use the Cordova command without putting it in the path yourself. So if you wanted to install other software, we would type npm install dash g and then the name of the software. And we can go to the Node website, the npm website, and look at all the software we can install. There's lots and lots and lots of software there. But for us, this is already installed. You don't need to install it. We've already got Cordova installed. And this is in my handouts, but I'm doing a quick overview here also. And then what we'll be doing in just a moment is to create a shell of a project that then we could use to deploy to Android, iOS, etc. The syntax of that, as we will see in a moment, Cordova, now the command is Cordova, create, and then some details of the particular project. I'll explain what they mean, of course. But that creates a shell of a project. Then we would go in to start to add the different platforms, simply with Cordova platform add, and then we add the platforms that we have the SDK for. We have the Android source code installed. Therefore, we can do Cordova platform add Android. If we try to do Cordova platform add iOS, it'll say cannot find SDK. And so if we try to do Cordova platform add BlackBerry 10, we don't have the BlackBerry software. So if we can download it to our system and install it, then yes, we can do Cordova platform add Amazon Fire OS, and then we'll have an Amazon version of our project. So we can add a Windows version, a Windows 8 version, a Mac OS 10 version, but we need the SDK. And all of those SDKs are downloadable. The catch, as I said previously, is if you're on Windows and you're trying to create a Mac app or an iPhone app, iOS, you will not be able to. You cannot install the SDK, the Mac SDK, the iOS SDK on a Windows computer. You just can't. The software isn't set up that way. Yes, there's virtual machines and all of that, but you're more advanced. So same thing with Mac people. If they wanted to create Windows phone apps, they would need the Windows SDK, free download, but it doesn't install on a Mac. You need Windows. Yes, you have virtualization and so forth, but again, if you know about that, you know what you're doing. You can remove platforms and then build. And so notice we can specifically say once we've got this stuff set up and our project is finished, so obviously we've jumped very far ahead, but then we could do Cordova build iOS. And it takes our HTML code, packages it, and makes an iPhone version of it. a .ipi, a .ipa file, an iPhone file. We could do Cordova build Android, and it would take all of HTML and translate it and give us a .apk file, an Android file. Or we could do Cordova build, and it'll do all the platforms at once if we've got the SDK installed. We're going to look at, okay, I want to see it in my virtual device. So we'll create a virtual device so we can see our project. I want to see my project in a virtual device. Cordova, emulate, and then which virtual device? My Android virtual device. This will load up your project in your virtual device. We will then see later today, okay, great, but I want to see it on my real device. Once it's set up, we'll do it together, we simply can run Cordova run Android, and it'll copy it over to your device. We'll talk about plugins, how to add the camera to take photos in our project, it's all there. Advanced plugins and so forth. So everything is here, how to do everything. It is a lot of reading, a lot of pages and such, but I've distilled it into these handouts. And we'll be spending time here then looking stuff up here. How does this work? Why doesn't this work? Over at the site. So, any questions so far? Well, specifically which part? The plugins, unfortunately, there's no catch-all, but I have a shortcut for you that I'll provide you. Because as we see here, yes, it is saying to add the different plugins, and it's saying one by one. That's annoying, there's 18 of them. I'm going to give you a little shortcut in a bit, how to add them all at once. Oh, good point. Okay, so you might have heard of the alternative to phone gap to Cordova, which is PhoneGap. If you take a quick look at PhoneGap.com, PhoneGap.com is going to look very similar to Apache, except that the difference is that PhoneGap is Adobe's version of Cordova. Just like open source, many open source projects, it can be forked, and then different organizations can have different goals for their copy. That's what Amazon has built their business on. They took Android, they forked it, and they made an Amazon version of it for their Kindles. And so with Apache Cordova, there's a version of it, it's been forked. Adobe, the people behind Photoshop and Dreamweaver and Flash and all of that, have a version that is 99% the same. So if you find any tutorials that tell you do this in your PhoneGap project, it's basically the same in Cordova. The big difference is that PhoneGap is coupled with Adobe's build system, which for a fee, they will convert your project to all the platforms. Even though you don't have the Mac SDK, the iOS SDK, you can have Adobe, you know, PhoneGap build do it for you. So that might be a big positive to go with PhoneGap rather than Cordova, because they do that part. They take your app, they compile it for all the platforms. How much does it cost? Well, let's take a quick look. It's free for the first project. Mm-hmm. But most of us will probably have more than one project. So if this loads up, we can see that. But yeah, in short, there's going to be a free one. And then when you want to make more projects, there'll be a price. Oh, I believe it comes with a version of it. Somewhere here in the documentation, if you do have Adobe Creative Cloud, you get a version of it. I don't know every nuance of of this, unfortunately, because I don't use it. My company doesn't use it. We do the phone gap, the Cordova version. But for some companies, it might work really well for them. So if you want to have a private app, because there's the open one that everyone will see your code, you might not want that. Your competitors might see your code. Well, you get one private app, but if you want more apps than that, you have to go to the paid plans. How big can your app be? 50 megabytes? That might be great for all your apps. It might be too small for your game. So they have 100 megs and 1 gigabyte. Can you use all the core plugins? Yes. Can you use third-party plugins? Yes. Can you upload your own plugins? No, with the free one, but yes, with the paid one. Can you have collaborators? Unlimited. And how much does it cost? Well, the basic one is completely free, one app. But then the more powerful ones are starting at $9.99 per month. So for some companies, that's great. That's a great price. Now my app is on all the platforms. But for some of us, it's not an investment we're going to make. So that's what we'll be talking, focusing on Cordova. But core-wise, Apache Cordova and Adobe PhoneGap are the same. The final step about compiling it and such for the different platforms, that's when they differ.
Open source, you can
still use that one for free. Yeah. Okay, so again, we'll get to this very soon. We'll get to the actual creating of the shell project in just a moment. What I want to do first, though, is create a virtual device so that I can see what this looks like after I create it. And then in a little bit, we'll then set up our real device. So we can go back and refer to the previous instructions. If you need to refer to something, we'll do it together in just a bit. But it's going to be under sheet 2B, or just 2A, I mean, Campus 2 Android Studio, page 2, set up a virtual device. We'll do it together right now. So. On our computers, open the computer window, go to the local disk C, C as in cat, open the Android SDK folder, that's where all the source code is at for Android, open that, open your AVD manager, your Android Virtual Device Manager, double click that. You should see that we don't have any devices just yet. Switch to the device definitions tab. Now, even if you're going to be using your real device, I still recommend to create a virtual device because sometimes, and you'll see on your own, sometimes it's faster to run your app on the virtual device than run it on your real device. And then later on, we'll see, actually, we can even run our app in the Google Chrome browser. We're getting ahead of ourselves, though. We're going to create a virtual device. We're going to create the basic, simple device that we did previously. You might be able to run the other devices, but we'll just use the basic one. So scroll down to find the one that is called 3.2-inch QVGA ADP2. Click on that one time. And on the right side, select Create AVD. So we're using this template, the 3.2-inch QVGA one, not the one that says slider. There's two 3.2s, the one that's ADP2. Click the Create AVD. At the top, it asks for a name. We can leave that name alone. But if you've got multiple devices, it might be a good idea to change that name to reflect it. Because maybe this is my low-quality device. And later on, I make another one that is my medium-quality device. And later on, I make one that is a tablet. So I'm going to forget what they are, possibly, so you can change that name. I won't, because we'll only have one device. We'll be fine. Don't change the device, because that's the one from our template. On target, you'll have to select the Google APIs, the Google specific code. There must be some subtle difference between the Android version of the code and the Google version of the code. I'm not going to worry about it, so just select Google API, which will then allow us to select the CPU, Google API for Intel Atom. There's no other option there. But what that is about is you can have different kinds of CPUs that emulate the device, and this Intel Atom will be the one that we'll be using. Do not turn off the hardware keyboard, that way we can type on the keyboard instead of clicking each letter. On skin, we need to select the first one, skin with dynamic hardware controls. That's so that we can get the volume button and the power button and all of that. That device does not have a front-facing camera, so that's fine. And then under back camera, select emulated. If you're on your own computer, you can choose webcam if you want. But for us, we will select emulated. Leave the memory options alone. Leave the internal storage alone. SD card, we'll insert a 99 megabyte SD card. Size on that doesn't really matter. I usually do 99 because my hand's already at the keyboard and I just can type that quickly. Now, quick question. If you tried this at home and you did it exactly as we did any of you get your virtual device to work? Okay, if you got it to work, was it slow or fast or medium? What would you say? Pretty fast, okay. You're over there, fast also. Okay, if it was slow or medium speed, maybe it would help to turn on host GPU. For us, I'll leave it off, because it seems to work fine for us on our computers. But if you tried this at home and it was much slower than class, maybe try to create a virtual device with the host GPU usage. For us, we don't need it. And don't worry about the snapshot either, so just click OK. It might take a moment to process that. You might get not responding for a moment. Just wait. And then it's going to tell you this is what you just did. Great. Click OK. And then now it goes back to the device manager here. Click on Start. Don't worry about any of these extra launch options. Just launch. And then wait for it to load. And everything that I just said came from instruction number 2, set up an Android virtual device, page 2. So let's wait for that to launch. You're going to get a new item that pops up here, so just keep an eye out for it. At this point, actually, if you would like, you can close the virtual device manager because it's taking a little bit of RAM and resources. So you don't get too much feedback at this point. Maybe you can wait until you actually see the new window pop up down here to be safe, but usually at this point, after the little bar progresses, at this point you can turn off your device manager. I'll wait just a moment. And I'm going to say that once we've got our device running, I don't recommend for the rest of the day to turn it off. That is, don't close your window of your device, virtual device, throughout the day. Just because if we are then doing further testing, you'll have to wait for it to start every time. It's fine for you to just leave this running and put it there in the corner and let it hang out, and we'll use it as the day goes on. Because if you do the X out here to close that item, you'll have to wait for it to launch every time. You could put it into power off mode, but it doesn't matter. But I definitely don't close the virtual device throughout the day. I will close the device manager. I'm done with this. I'm not going to launch any more devices at the moment, so I'll close that to free up a little bit of resources. And I'm going to wait for this to fully boot up. I'm also going to close the window that I had open for the SDK, just for me, because I need all my resources since I'm doing this and recording it all. But for you, you'll probably be okay. Okay, so I'm gonna let that hang out in the background. It's gonna come up in just a moment. I'm gonna go back to my handout where I'm talking about setup Cordova. We'll talk in general what instructions I've got here, then we'll do it. So here I have that Cordova is a framework that lets us write code that we're familiar with and then translate the code that then the device understands. It is what allows us to upgrade a simple web app into something that can access the features of your device and can be distributed in app stores. Modern Cordova requires a bit of command line interface, CLI, or CLI, however you want to say it. My device seems to be coming up now, and it's saying, okay, backup, whatever. Click and drag upwards to unlock it, just like a real device. Click OK on that message. What I like to do when I first launch my device is I swipe it up, I click that OK button, I open the app drawer, the little app icon there, so that I can close that message, and then just go back home. So my device is running here, and then I'll proceed to create a shell app, a basic app, so that then I can deploy it and actually get to work. Question?
Yeah, I feel like I'm following the instructions to do this, where it says click OK, the OK becomes available.
Well, you're missing this part here on target. You need to change that to Google API. Mm-hmm. And then you get the option of CPU and all of that, and then you've got the OK.
This is, we were doing
this? No, don't use it. And on the next screen, click launch, and then it should, you should get it. Mm-hmm. All right, so did everyone get a virtual device running? All right, so again, I'm going to leave that there on its own. Back to my instructions here. We've already got Cordova installed, so you don't have to do this one. Again, that's going to waste your time and bandwidth because it's just going to erase itself next time at home. We've already got the node command prompt running, and here, don't do this, but at home you would type in npm install -g Cordova, and then we would check the version and we'd see we've got 5.1.1. On our particular computers, we saw a moment ago, or actually I don't think we've done it yet, but on the command prompt, if we type Cordova space -v, we have 5.00. So don't worry about updating it. It's going to be a waste of time, and our network is super slow. And this is saying that on number four, okay, it's not exactly in the instructions, but we'll do this right now in the command prompt. I'm in my instructor folder. You're in your lab folder. You're on the C drive, users, C drive / users / lab. Mine says instructor. I want to change to the desktop. So we'll type cd, change directory, space, desktop, press enter. Now we're on the desktop. Question? Dash V.
Cordova space -v.
Mm-hmm. And you got what?
I got a thing that says it's not a recognized internal command.
Did anyone get that, or am I getting ahead of myself? Cordova -v. Did anyone else get that Cordova is not a recognized command? Or did everyone get a version number?
050.
Yeah, me too, so you're on track.
Cordova -v.
Okay. Then in your case, I think you'll have to do the original instruction for it. Okay, so you go ahead and try that one. That one to do the npm install -g Cordova. I think that'll fix that problem. All right, so we're on the desktop. And then in my instructions here, I'm saying, okay, let's create a test project. So the command is going to be usually preceded with Cordova. We're running the Cordova app, and we're saying Cordova space create, because with Cordova we can create, we can build, we can install, we can do all of this stuff. We're going to create something, Cordova create. And what I've got here listed is this particular syntax, which I'll explain here. The very first item is a folder. This is going to create a brand new folder wherever you are in the command prompt. So I'm saying create a folder called test2. If you want to call it anything else, no problem. Type whatever you want there. Then we're typing what is known as the package name here. We saw that when we looked at Android Studio previously. Remember there was a part there that said put in your company's website. Well, we're doing it here manually, and it's in reverse order. It has to be this way. It's in com.yourlastname.the name of your app, which, to make it easy, is the name of your folder. And then at the very end, in quotes, we can write the name of the app that will appear in the icon. So we have got a capital letter there and a space. So that's how it'll look in the actual icon. So just to follow the instructions, we will do that. Cordova create space com dot your last name. You might not have a real website. That's fine. Just type your last name dot this specific app. Oops. Let's back up. The name of the folder, test02. We did test1 last time. Then we've got com.campos, your last name, dot the name of the app, test02. So basically use the name of the folder that you wrote here as the name of your project there. Later on, when we're making our app and such, our real app, you know, we would write the real name of the app there. And this can be edited later. Right now we're still kind of testing it out. Space. I'll type a quote. You can do the quote like we got to used to last time, and then back up in there. Quote. And then right here we'll call it test with a capital T, space 02. That's the name that will appear below the icon. And then press enter. It'll say creating a new Cordova project. If it didn't work, it'll give you an error. Yes?
So test02 is the folder name?
Yes.
And campus test02 is the project name?
It is the package name. Okay. This is the name that the Google Play Store or the Amazon App Store or the iTunes App Store will how it will refer to your app internally. So it's the unique identifier of your app to the world.
And the test02 then?
That is the name that appears on the icon, under the icon of your app. If you did not get an error, if it said creating a new Cordova project, great. Now type dir to view that directory, and we should see that you've got a directory called test2. So did everyone get that? You've got a brand new directory for your test2 project. Okay, so following along on my instructions, what follows next is we need to be inside of that project, because we can have multiple projects. The very cool thing about this is, I'm going to take a quick detour here, you don't have to do this, but if I go to my desktop on a regular Explorer window, I have a folder there that is called test2. That's my whole project at the moment. So we'll talk about it in a bit. Well, what if I do this on my USB drive? We'll get to that. But your whole project is that one folder there on your desktop, and at the moment it's only 48 kilobytes. But anyway, we need to change directory into that directory, so we'll type cd space, and then I'll show you a trick here. Start typing TES. Right now, our folder name is not that complicated. We can type it. But if we have a complicated folder name or file, we don't need to type that huge name. The trick is, as you start typing a name here, and then press tab on the keyboard, it'll fill it in for you. So let me show you this. Let's say I wanted to open Document Shortcut Link, as I start to type documents, I'm already tired, press tab. Okay, because it's got a space, it didn't do it. But let's say CMap tools. That's weird. Oh, because it's not a directory. It's not a directory. I don't have any directories that have a huge name, but let's say Ubuntu. I'm starting to type U tab Ubuntu. I'm just trying to show you, this is a shortcut. If you've got these file, these folder names, like maybe RGISOs, you can start typing one or two letters of it, RG tab, and then it types the rest for you. And in this case, because this directory had a space, I have to put it in quotes, and it did it for me. This is a time saver that I'll be mentioning. Because if you don't type it exactly right, it won't work. But if we use tab, that'll be a shortcut for us. We just need to start typing a little bit of the file name. Question?
When I typed in DIR in Search Desktop, it gave me the directory for the desktop, but then my CPOM went back to user slash left.
Well, you're going to type dir to view the directory, but you're going to type cd to change to the directory. You have to type cd, then desktop, or test2, and then you'll be in it. You'll see it in your command prompt here, that you're in it.
Gotcha. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm in the directory test2 now. This is a shell of a project, and now I want to specifically add the code for an Android project. Cordova platform add Android. So running the Cordova app, application software, specifically we're dealing with platforms, we're adding. If we can add a platform, we can remove a platform. If it needs, we can kill it. And so we've got Android, that's the one we're adding. Press enter. This will take a little longer to process. It's going to give you some feedback.
Can you please explain what
it is? Yeah, I just did. I said that Cordova is the software that we're running, and we're specifically saying run the platform command. We have other commands that we can run related to Cordova, and then specifically add or remove a platform. Which platform? The Android platform.
Do we have to do this in time, or
when we create a project for the first time? This particular test2 project is a completely basic shell. It doesn't know what kind of project it will be. So at the very beginning, one of our first steps is we need to tell it, this is going to be an Android project. And that's what that command just did. Question? Did you create the test too?
No.
That's the instruction.
No, no.
Well, let's look at your handout. So you need to do this properly. You already did install code a little bit. You now take it from the explore the test too. So
I'm sure you have this in back to you.
It's going to do it once you type that command. Now here I added the Android specific platform, the code for Android, and it gives me this feedback adding Android. It's looking inside of your computer to see that we've got the Android source code. It's copying those files and adding it to the project, and then doing some other stuff that I don't quite need to mention what's happening just yet, but it created now a skeleton for an Android project, for the Android platform. Let's type Cordova platform, just by itself like that, Cordova platform, and press enter. What that's saying is we're running the Cordova software with its platform command. And what this says is, we've installed the Android package, the Android platform. And these are the ones that we can add to it. We can add the Amazon platform, BlackBerry, browser, Firefox, Windows. Notice it does not mention iOS. We can't add the iPhone specific code. And if we do this on a Mac, Cordova platform, it'll show all of this except the Windows and the Windows 8 stuff, because they're just not compatible. If you're on Linux, you would see it all, basically. But we're going to add another platform. It won't make sense what it is just yet, but we're going to add Cordova platform space add browser. Cordova platform add browser. What that does is then it connects to the NPM repository. It downloads the code that is compatible, so that now we have the browser platform. This is kind of cool. It won't make much sense for us at the moment, but this will allow us to run our project in a web browser. And you think, well, what's so special about that? We were doing it the whole last month. Well, once we've upgraded to an Android kind of project, it doesn't run properly in a regular web browser. It's expecting to run on an Android device. But by adding the browser platform and having Google Chrome will act like an Android device, kind of, and will allow us to run our project in Google Chrome like a website. But then it'll also be able to tap into to some aspects of a device, like a camera. So from the web browser, you'll be able to take a photo like if it was a real device. Now I've got an item here, number 6, where it says, okay, we would type this to add the platforms. Don't type this just yet. Let me explain what this is. Not the platforms, the plugins. We've got Cordova plugin add, like we've had Cordova platform add. So we're running the Cordova software, we're running its plugin command, specifically add. We have add, we have remove, we have update. And then we're saying, okay, Cordova-plugin-device space Cordova-plugin-network-information space Cordova-plugin-battery-status space. So these are all the possible plugins. These are all of the features that we can now tap into of a device with JavaScript. We'll be able to load a splash screen. We'll be able to make the app vibrate. We'll be able to load a mini web browser inside the app. You see that often. Let's say you're using your Twitter app. You see a tweet with a link. You click the link and a mini web browser appears to view the web. You close the web browser, you're still in Twitter. We'll be able to do that with the in-app browser. All of these plugins. And I'm not saying type that because you're going to misspell it. I believe we can copy and paste from this, but it's better to copy and paste from this other file that I have for you. This is the shortcut that I mentioned earlier. In the network drive. In the network drive, I've put a simple text file called Cordova plugins all. That text file, I've already put all the commands in one long line that we just copy and paste. So you want to drag a copy of that Cordova plugins all text file to your desktop or USB. Open that text file. Select that huge line there. Select the whole thing, right-click copy, go back to the command prompt, right-click paste. Don't do Control-V, it doesn't work. You have to right-click paste into the command prompt. And it copied the whole thing there instead of you having to type it and mistype it. Enter. It's going to connect to the repository, get every one of those plugins, download them, install them, activate them. And now our app will be able to use basically every feature of a mobile device so that it's a real app.
So let that go for a moment.
Everyone on track? Anyone? No, if you didn't write test two in the quotes, we can edit that later when we get back to actually editing code and hope that quotes will be able to edit it. So if you mistyped anything on our initial Cordova create, we will be able to edit all of that a little bit. Anyone else? Any other questions or comments? Okay, so just to confirm this, when this is done, type Cordova. Just type Cordova plugin. Cordova plugin. And that should give you feedback that says you've installed the battery plugin, the camera plugin, the notification plugin, and the version numbers. If you count them, there should be 19 of them. So you should be seeing that this is going to be the syntax. We're going to write Cordova and then something. Cordova create. Cordova plugin. We could have Cordova plugin add. We could have Cordova build Android. So that'll be the syntax. The main Cordova software, a particular command, and then some options, perhaps. So if we've got all of this working so far, my instructions further go on. Type Cordova plugin to see that, and then if you'd like, then you can type Cordova platform. I think we already did that one. Cordova platform. Yeah, we did that one. But now, if we type Cordova platform, now it says the currently installed platforms are Android and the browser. Remember when we did it the first time, it only said Android. Now we've got two platforms to work with. Cordova platform. And then we go on here, Cordova emulate Android to run your project in your virtual device. So now, that's why we took a moment to create a virtual device. There's mine right there, hanging around. At this point, then we'll type Cordova emulate. Now we're running the emulate command of Cordova. So think of it as if we had a nice graphical user interface and there was a button that said emulate or a button that said add plugin. Here we're typing it directly. Cordova emulate Android. That'll process for a moment. I'm going to open my virtual device right there and wait for it. For the feedback to tell me it put it onto the device. Let's try this one more time. Cordova platform. That's good. Space Android. So it's right over here. So that's the
it over, brush down from one and go all the way down.
Yes.
So, and you've got your virtual image on perfect.
Yes.
So start from one and go on. Actually, start from four. You don't need to install Cordova anymore. It's already done. So start from four.
So let me place this right here. I type everything. All of this has to be typed in because when I got sulfur.
You didn't put a space after the number two. But I guess you're okay. So you did do that one, you did number four, yeah. So now it's number five. Yeah. See how it says putting into a project? If it didn't work, we would have told you.
Okay.
That would work. So take it from number five, see you test two.
So if it worked, what should eventually happen is your virtual device then pops up something that says Apache Cordova device is ready. There's the little Cordova mascot. And then you've got this glowing device is ready. Well, everyone, attention please. I'm talking. So once you've got that running like that, that's our app. That's the extent of what our current basic Android project is. If you got it to run in your virtual device now, click on the home button of the virtual device to take us to the home here, and then click on the apps icon down there, the little circle, and then if you look around here, because it's in alphabetical order, you're gonna swipe over page 2 and look at that. There's my test 2 app. It's actually installed as a real app on the device. There's the test 2 that we wrote in capital letters. We never defined an icon, so it comes with a built-in icon, but we'll be able to edit that, of course.
And so that app is right there, and if you click it, it loads up again. Device is ready. So that's the extent of what this project does at the moment. It just says device ready. It doesn't do anything at all. But this is major. We've got an Android app. We're going to take a break in a moment, and then we're going to talk about setting up our real device so that we can see that on a real device. And then if nothing else, you can then show your friends and family, look, I got an Android app that I made. It doesn't do anything, but you made it yourself. Just one moment. So it's 7:25. Let's take a 10-minute break. We'll be back at 7:35, and we'll go on to these other sheets about setting up our device and all of that.